For the today's session, we're going to be discussing, like in continuation to parliamentary privileges, law courts, and the effect of privileges. So, Article 105, if we read it with Article 194, subjects the power and privileges and immunities of each house, as well as all its members and all its committees, not only to the laws made by the appropriate legislature, but also to all other provisions of the Constitution. Both these articles, far from dealing with the legislative powers of the Houses of Parliament or of the state legislature, respectively, are confined in scope to such powers of each house as it may exercise separately, functioning as a house. A House of Parliament or legislature cannot try anyone or any case directly as a court of justice can, but it can proceed quasi-judicially in cases of contempt of its authority or take up motions concerning its privileges and immunities in order to seek removal of obstructions to the due performance of its legislative function. If any question of jurisdiction arises as to a certain matter, it has to be decided by a court of law in appropriate proceedings. For example, the jurisdiction to try a criminal offense such as murder committed even within a house vests in ordinary courts and not in a parliament or in a state legislature. Also, a House of Parliament or state legislature cannot, in exercise of any supposed power under Article 105 and Article 194, decide election dispute for which special authorities have been constituted under the Representation of People's Act 1951, enacted in compliance with Article 329. Parliamentary privileges and fundamental rights. So in the case of Pandit MSM Sharma's, it was also contended by the petitioner that the privileges of the House under Article 194, subclause 3, are subject to the provisions of the Part 3 of the Constitution. In support of his contention, the petitioner relied on the Supreme Court's decision in Gunupati Keshwar Ram Reddy versus Nafisul Hasan. In this latter case, Homi Mistry was arrested at his Bombay residence under a warrant issued by the Speaker of UP Assembly for contempt of the House and was flown to the Lucknow and kept in a hotel in Speaker's custody. On his applying for a writ of habeas corpus, the Supreme Court directed his release as he had been not produced before a magistrate within 24 hours of his arrest, as provided in Article 22, subclause 2. The decision therefore indicated that Article 194 or Article 105 was subject to the articles of Part 3 of the Constitution. In Sharma's case, the court held that in case of conflict between fundamental rights under Article 19, subclause 1, subclause A, and a privilege under Article 194, subclause 3, the latter would prevail. As regards Article 21, on the facts, the court did not find any violation of it. In powers, privileges, and immunities of the state legislature, regarding the proposition laid down in the Sharma's case, was explained not to mean that in all cases, the privileges shall override the fundamental rights. The rules of each house provide for a committee of privileges. The matter of breach of privilege or contempt is referred to the committee of privileges, and then it is this committee which has the power to summon the member or even strangers before it. Refusal to appear or to answer or to knowingly to give false answer is itself a contempt. The committee's recommendations are reported to the House, which discusses them and gives its own decision. Now we move on to discussing Article 194, powers, privileges, etc. So if we read Article 194, subclause 1 says, subject to the provisions of this Constitution and to the rules and the standing orders regulating the procedure of the legislature, there shall be freedom of speech in the legislature of every state. Moving on to subclause 2, no member of the legislature of a state shall be liable to any proceeding in any court in respect of anything said or any vote given by him in the legislature or any committee thereof. and no person shall be so liable in respect of the publication by or under the authority of a house of such a legislature of any report, paper, votes or proceedings. Subclause 3. In other respects, the powers, privileges and immunities of a house of the legislature of a state and its member and its committees of a house of such legislature shall be such as may be defined from time to time, be defined by the legislature by law, and until so defined shall be those of that house and of its members and committees immediately before coming into the force of section 26 of the Constitution, 44th Amendment Act, 1978. The provision of clauses 1, 2 and 3 shall apply in relation to persons who by the virtue of this constitution have the right to speak in and otherwise take part in the proceedings of a house of legislature of a state or any other committee thereof as they apply in relation to the members that of legislature. So if we discuss and if we look at those above mentioned clauses, the clause 1 of the said article declares that there shall be freedom of speech in the legislature of every state, but this freedom is subject to the provisions of Articles 208 and 211. A member cannot accordingly raise discussions as to the conduct of a Supreme Court or High Court judge, as Article 211 prohibits it. The provisions of the Constitution subject to which the freedom of speech has been conferred on the legislature are not the general provisions of the Constitution, but only such of them as relate to the regulation of the procedure of the legislature. The freedom of speech guaranteed to citizens under Article 19(1)(a) is therefore separate and independent of Article 194(1) subclause 1 and does not control the first part of the clause 1 of Article 194. The clause 2 emphasizes the fact that the freedom of speech conferred on the legislature under clause 1 is intended to be absolute and unfettered. Similar freedom is guaranteed to the legislators in respect of the votes they may give in the legislature or committees thereof. Hence, if a legislator exercises a right of freedom of speech in violation of Article 211, he would not be liable for any action in any court. Likewise, if a legislator by his speech or vote is alleged to have violated any of the fundamental rights guaranteed by Part 3 of the Constitution in the legislative assembly, he will not be answerable for the said contravention in any court. If the speech amounts to libel or becomes actionable or indicatable under any other provision of the law, immunity has been conferred on him from any action in any court by clause 2. He may be answerable to the House for such a speech, and the Supreme Court may take appropriate action against him in respect of it. Hence, a clause subclause 1 confers freedom of speech to the legislator within the legislative chambers, and clause 2 make it plain that the freedom is literally absolute. Clause 3, the first part of this clause empowers the state legislature to make laws prescribing its power, privileges and immunities. If the legislature of a state under the first part of the clause 3 makes a law which prescribes its power, privileges and immunities, such a law would be subject to Article 13, and Clause 2 of that article would render it void if it contravenes or abridges any of the fundamental rights guaranteed by Part 3. The right of state legislatures to punish for contempt can be discussed with the case law of powers, privileges and immunities of state legislature, regarding which the reference was a sequel to the passing of an order by an unprecedented full bench of 28 judges staying under Article 226, the implementation of the UP. Assembly resolution ordering two judges of Allahabad High Court to be brought in custody before the bar of House to explain why they should not be punished for the contempt of the House. The two judges had admitted that habeas corpus petition of and granted bail to one Keshav Singh, who was undergoing imprisonment in pursuance of the assembly resolution declaring him guilty of the breach of privilege. The resolution of the assembly and the stay of the order issued by the full bench resulted in a constitutional stalemate. Consequently, the president referred the matter under Article 143 to the Supreme Court for its opinion. The Supreme Court, by a majority of 6-1, through an elaborate and learned opinion delivered by Chief Justice Gajendra Gadkar held that in India, notwithstanding a general warrant issued by the assembly, the courts could examine the legality of the committal in proper proceedings. Other propositions were also laid down in the majority judgment. It said that Article 194 sub clause 3 cannot be read in isolation. The impact of Article 226, 32 and 211 has to be ascertained in order to determine the scope of Article 194. Article 226 empowers the High Court to issue a writ of habeas corpus against any authority. This would include the legislature, since no exception is made in favor of a detention order by the House for the breach of its privileges, of his duties, and can never become the subject matter of any action taken by the House in exercise of its powers or privileges conferred by the later part of Article 194 sub clause 3. The fact that the first part of Article 194 sub clause 3 refers to the future laws defining the privileges as being subject to the fundamental rights is a significant factor in construing the later part of Article 194. Such a state legislation would be law within the meaning of Article 13, and the courts will be competent to examine its validity vis-a-vis the fundamental right. Although no opinion was tendered as regards fundamental rights in general, it was made clear that so far as Article 21 and 22 are concerned, any privileges, etc., which are claimed must be consistent with these articles in the context of Article 208. While concluding this session, I would like to say that there is a clear demarcation as to what all the rights and privileges are absolute and what are not. For example, in India, the Legislative Assemblies and the Parliament never discharge any judicial function, and their historical